And I mention that because whilst you're working in amongst those energies, you can have energies attached to yourself. And you have to stay fine-tuned. You just have to. And I sometimes forget, I get so busy, I say I don't have time to fast. But then when I do fast, I'm more productive. When I make time to do it, I become more productive. It's like a story I once heard about... I hope you can hear me over that. It's like a story I once heard about an old man and a young man who were cutting down trees, lumberjacks. And the young man, being young and strong and egoic, said, I can cut down more trees than you in a day. And the old man said, okay, let's see who wins. And the old man would cut down a tree and he would sit down and take a rest and then go around and cut down another one. And the young man just kept cutting and cutting and cutting and cutting. And at the end of the day, the old man had cut down more trees. And the young man said, how did you do that? I didn't take a break and I just kept cutting and cutting and cutting. And the old man said, well, when I sat down, I would sharpen my axe. And this is what fasting is. It's sharpening your axe so you can get through that tree with more ease. Hey guys, so I want to speak about something which is very important, and it's part of my own journey, but part of what should be part of everyone's journey, I think. Now, it's not an easy thing to do for many people, but I want to speak about how my experience with it is actually directly reflected in a scripture on the planet. And by that I mean literally what it describes in this scripture is what happens to a human being when they decide to go and undertake this process for themselves. Now, for certain, it's worded in very dramatic terms, as many old scriptures are. But it does definitely, without a doubt, relate to what happens to a human being when they do undertake this. Now, the thing I'm speaking about is fasting. And I've had many questions, and I think I've left perhaps a grey area with regards to my past and fasting experiences, etc. Now, many people say that to fast for 40 days and 40 nights is that which Jesus did. Now, in actual fact, when you look at the language of the ancient times, 40 days and 40 nights is a representation of a very long time. So it could have been that Jesus fasted for 50, 60 days. You just don't know. And that's why 40 days and 40 nights is a term used. It means for a very prolonged period, someone did something or something happened. It rained for 40 days and 40 nights. He wandered and fasted in the desert for 40 days and 40 nights. Just means a very long time. It could have meant 3 months, 5 months, 6 months. I mean, obviously, well, who knows? But it could mean any length of time, just a long time. This is what it represents. And I did my 40 days and 40 nights of fasting. And how it happened with I fasted for 7 days. I'd already done some fasting. My first long water fast, which I heard someone speak about, I saw someone speak about in my comments, was 11 days on the 11th of November, 2011. Now, that was the first time I'd undertaken a fast and said, this is what I'm doing. Other times I, for certain, had fasted. I had not eaten some days, or I'd eaten little just because I felt inclined to do that. But this was the first time I said, to draw closer to God, I will fast for 11 days and 11 nights, and I will not consume any food in that time. I will only consume water. And that's what I did. I drank water for 11 days and 11 nights. And it was that fast that brought me to Tanzania. Because it was in that fast that, as many of you know the story, that I grew emotional. And I watched a video on YouTube of children who were struggling here. You can see this in another video of mine. And I received an email on the last day of the fast from the organization, having applied whilst being upset in the middle of that fast and wanting to do something to help. I received a fast at 11:11 a.m. And as many of you out there are receiving the 11:11 sign from God, I knew this was where I was supposed to come. And that's why everything happened, was because I undertook that water fast. And I was in line enough, and I was present enough, and sensitive enough to see the signs that God needed to use to speak that subtle spiritual language, which is the language of the promised land where Moses was aiming to get to. The promised land flowing with milk and honey is the activation and the stimulation of your pineal and pituitary gland when they secrete the DMT, the honey, is a honey amber light substance, and the serotonin from the pituitary, which is a milky substance. So when you're in that place, the language that is spoken to you is very subtle and very gentle. And that's how, because of that initial water fast, there's now this community that I'm sitting in, that I have built with God, Feathers Tail. And this is where special needs children who have no parents or have single parents, who most of which were homeless, can live. I have the 600 plus children in the Children's Fund, over 60 rescue dogs now, and Angel's Gate, where the boys from the street stay. So all of this came off the back of fasting, a water fast, but also came off the back of following the signs that were brought to me that are a language of the spiritual realm whilst I was fasting. But that's not where my journey with fasting ended. And whilst you are fasting, it's nice to read about others who are going through it or to read information on it. It keeps you centered and focused on what's happening in my experience. And I was reading a lot of different works, and I read things from Saint Seraphim of Sarov while I was fasting. It was a little known Coptic saint. He left some small teachings, and they really resonated with me while I was fasting. I read a lot about Saint Francis of Assisi, who was very big on fasting and its necessity to draw close to God. I read about Gandhi, and in reading about Gandhi, I read about Dr. Shelton, because he consulted with Dr. Shelton, who is no longer with us in this earthly plane, but he fasted more people than any other doctor in history to cure them of all many different ailments, from cancer to chronic heart disease to everything else in between, with prolonged water fasts observed by himself and documented by himself as well. So I began to read Shelton's work whilst fasting as well, so I became clued up about how my body would react during the fast. And for all Shelton's work is all very scientific, he started to speak a lot about the spiritual gifts that are bestowed upon you, the sensitivity that you go through whilst you're fasting. Your intuitive body comes alive. And that is truly what happens. Now, I mentioned that I'd read the scripture, which is perfectly in line with this. Now, first of all, the mention of fasting in the Bible is quite plentiful, but many people don't read it correctly, because Jesus did say, when you fast. He never said if, he said when. Now, of course, fasts can take different forms. So some people might fast, they might just eat a certain food for a prolonged period of time, which is fine. They might cut down to one meal a day, which again is fine. All fasts that are done to lead you closer to God are indeed equal to one another. I myself, however, having lived a life of a great deal of sin, and due to that was laden with the past energies that I had picked up along the way whilst living that life. You know, the drug taking, the mindless and the meaningless interactions with persons of the opposite sex, and all of these things leave you spiritually very polluted, and you need to cleanse yourself physically, spiritually. You need to purge these things out of you. And fasting is the most rapid way I've seen to heal and to cleanse and to purge those energies from you. Now in the Bible it says, this kind cometh out except through fasting and prayer. Now I, as a man, could not in any way stop smoking. I used to smoke and it was getting ridiculous. The drug taking, the alcohol, smoking. I couldn't stop off the back of my own willpower. I couldn't do it. I wasn't strong enough. I was losing my fight with the lion, which is what the fight of Samson and the lion represents. Your lower nature is the beast. It doesn't mean that a lion is a beast, a lower being. It's just represented in the language of esoterics that the lion is the lower nature, the uncontrollable, ravenous beast, which is the best animal to describe it as. For all that's not literally what they are, this is how it was described in that language. In Greek, ancient Greek mysticism, they used a minotaur, a bull-headed creature, to represent the raging ego, the beast of the raging, the beast that represents your raging ego, in the maze, which is the labyrinth of your mind and the psychological, mental, emotional, and spiritual journey you go on internally, is that maze that the minotaur dwells in. Now, I've mentioned this before. This kind cometh out except through fasting and prayer. I realized that I was purging these entities, if you like, or these energy patterns, if you like, or these habits, if you want to come to a more direct psychological way, or a means of using psychology to describe it. Habits I had programmed into my subconscious would be a modern day term. Old terms would be entity, negative energy, demon. This is what they were speaking of when they said this kind cometh out except through fasting and prayer. So in fasting, I did indeed manage to shake the back of all these problems, but not only that, there was no temptation anymore, but it took more than one fast to do that. And I did my 40 days and 40 nights, as I say, but before I did that as well, I read the Essenes, the Essene Gospel of Peace. And it speaks of fasting in there, of a way to have true health. And it's very, very true. There was never a truer word spoken. And it speaks of the healing crisis that you go through whilst you're fasting. Now, when I fasted for a long time, there was a time where I fasted. I did 7 days and I decided I would break the fast, and I ate half a cantaloupe melon. And I decided to go back to fasting because I didn't feel right eating. And I stayed the course for a further 28 days. And then I slowly began to lead myself back into food, but I didn't really take in proper calories for about a week after I broke the fast, like a proper calorie source, something high in glucose like watermelon, etc. And it was around about altogether 30 something days, including a little half a cantaloupe melon, but still a long fast ultimately. And during that period, I really dove deep into the cleansing of myself, and I'd done others for 3 weeks and for 4 weeks and so on and so forth, but my longest was this 7 days, half a cantaloupe melon, and then 4 weeks on top of that, 4 weeks and a bit on top of that, I think it was. And it truly, I began to have a true fight. I was dancing with the devil. Now in the Essenes Gospel they refer to it as Beelzebub, but they say that as you fast, you will start to tear him from you and his unclean spirits and the habits and the lower aspects of your nature that do drag you into these horrible behaviors that are weak and that do not make you a good human. They do not make you a good man or a good woman. Overindulging in the physical pleasures, etc. They only weaken you. They just make you a weakling, ultimately, in the realms of the spiritual world, because you're exposed to everything. And this is when you begin to pursue God. If you're going to make your temple, which is your body, a dwelling place for God, you must make sure it's clean. Now the Essenes, I'll let you read it yourselves if you have not, and read about healing crisis if you haven't undergone a long fast, but it speaks of the pains that you will go through and the pain you will feel in your joints and how you will purge dark matter from your body. And it's very true. You pass things, toxins from your body, and it says that you will smell and stink from your mouth, and you do. You have a real bad odor from your mouth as your body purges all of the toxins from over the years. But while it's purging toxins, you begin bringing up psychological problems as well, because don't forget, if you have muscle memory, and as is evidenced in persons who have had heart transplants and have had the cravings of the person they've taken the heart from, your memory cells do not just dwell within your mind, and the memory of your body is everywhere, and thus the storage of wounds can be stored in toxins in your body. And as you fast in depth and you begin to do, you're wrestling the lion. This is what you're doing. You've got your fists up. You've got your fists up, and in the northeast they would say you've come out, in northeast of England they would say you've come out windmilling is a term they would use. And you're just going for it. You're fighting Beelzebub. All the darkness that dwelled in you, all of the weakness that dwelled in you, you've said, right, I'm taking you out of me, and you can fight me all you want while that happens. And I would get periods of very, even if it was just fleeting for a few minutes, very dark feelings and emotions, and then they would pass. And I presume that this was the purging of my subconscious, of the wrongs I had committed, of the darkness I had lived, of the pain I had caused others. And these things create energy inside you, and I was tearing that out of myself. And as Samson wrestled that lion, the best way we can all wrestle our lion is in fasting, as far as I've seen. I've not seen a faster way to overcome the beast within. I truly have not. And during the fast, as I say, your tongue will be coated and you'll start to have foul-smelling breath, and even your sweat will be very smelly, and you'll be uncomfortable. You'll get headaches. Some days you'll feel great, other days you'll feel terrible. But you're undoing the wrongs physically that you've done to your body and the toxins you've had to store through that. You're undoing the wrongs psychologically that you've done to your body, and the things you have done will come to the forefront of your mind. The things you feel shame for, the things you feel guilt for, they'll rise up, and you've just got to brave it. And you're by yourself. No one can carry you through it. You're on your own, but God is there. And as it says in the Essenes, as soon as you raise up, as soon as you challenge the lower nature, or Beelzebub, as it would say in the Essenes, then the angels of your mother will come to support you. But not only that, they will do your will. And your mother is, for instance, they deem it as the angel of the air. So your mother is the earth inside the Essenes. And they say the angel of the water. Now, of course, these can also be non-literal. As you all know, there are the stages of consciousness. There are earth, water, air, fire, new mind. And of course, the angel of air, for example, and the angel of water could be the stages of your mind, because the frequency of your brain will alter. You will move through beta, alpha, theta, delta whilst you're fasting. You have no choice. Media and stuff's too intense. Your body can't cope with it, so you're forced. And fasting and fighting this fight in these prolonged fasts, I've done several. Many. I don't even know how many long fasts I've done, actually, but I did a lot. I really don't know how many, but it was a lot. You probably can't count them on two hands. And in doing them, it made me who I am. It made me the man I am today. And now, having gone through all of that and having put myself in a position where I'm serving God daily, every single day I'm serving God. And every single day, that energy that I had to purge from myself, or those energies, those entities, those demons, as the traditional language would say, that I had to purge from myself, I am doing battle with them every single day. And not necessarily my own, but the ones that I see in others. When you have a whole platoon, if you like, a whole home filled with over 20 boys with trauma, who have lived on the streets, who have been thieves, who have been sexually abused, who have sexually abused or been taught to sexually abuse, and you need to heal them, then you're at war with Beelzebub. And everywhere you turn, it's there. But one thing you always remember is that he can be removed. And love and light can remove those problems, can remove those entities, can remove those habits that we've programmed into our subconscious, can remove those demons, to use the words of the biblical ages. And you can remove them even, I do believe, from others with your energy as well. Healing shall spring forth from those who fast is something that is written. And this is also something I've seen to be true. And now I have that energetically here. Sometimes I can sit with persons in a great deal of pain and I'll grow to be exhausted. I start yawning even. And it's, I believe, an energy exchange going on. And I don't mind that. But when you have a house full of boys who have all been, most of which have been abused, etc., and have taken drugs and stole and whatever else they've done, dark things on the street, in the world, through the gates of hell, that's where they've been, through the gates of hell, then, sorry, the neighbor's generator, then it's gloves off in that realm of things as well. And I mention that because whilst you're working in amongst those energies, you can have energies attached to yourself. And you have to stay fine-tuned. You just have to. And I sometimes forget, I get so busy, I say I don't have time to fast. But then when I do fast, I'm more productive. When I make time to do it, I become more productive. It's like a story I once heard about, I hope you can hear me over that. It's like a story I once heard about an old man and a young man who were cutting down trees, lumberjacks. And the young man, being young and strong and egoic, said, "I can cut down more trees than you in a day." And the old man said, "Okay, let's see who wins." And the old man would cut down a tree and he would sit down and take a rest and then go around and cut down another one. And the young man just kept cutting and cutting and cutting and cutting. And at the end of the day, the old man had cut down more trees. And the young man said, "How did you do that? I didn't take a break and I just kept cutting and cutting and cutting." And the old man said, "Well, when I sat down, I would sharpen my axe." And this is what fasting is. It's sharpening your axe so you can get through that tree with more ease. And I'm guilty of it, even I who advocate fasting as a very powerful spiritual tool and have undertaken a great deal of fasts and found nothing but massive benefits from them. They changed me, they made me who I am. They cleared my temple and made space for God. But even I struggle with it. I say, I don't have time for that. When I make time, I become more productive. And there's a science behind that. There's a reason you become more productive when you water fast or when you put yourself through endurance exercise. The same thing happens, but I'll make a separate video about the science of it all. I'm also wanting to speak about the spiritual aspect of it all and how it does heal everything. Spiritual, physical, emotional, psychological. I've never seen it not heal these things. Now, I'm not saying all physical things can be healed. There are things that cannot be healed. There are times where you should not fast. But if you study Shelton's work, if you're debating doing a fast, then it will tell you what those things are. And if you're really fearful and you don't want to do it, then you can go to fasting clinics and do it there, where people observe you, doctors observe you. But I myself, I didn't feel a need for that, and I've managed to fast safely. But you should know the science, and you should know your limits and your boundaries when you undertake it. And you should do it with God. You should not do it to lose weight, and you should not do it for this, that, or the other. Do it for God. And do it to fight the fight that is spoken about in every single scripture. To dance the dance with the lion and to win. to dance the dance with Beelzebub and to win, to dance the dance with Satan, as most would call it, and to remove him from your life, to take all of his hooks out of your body, and to find strength so as you can get out in the world and you can serve God and you can be around those who are so laden with, as the ancient language would say, legions of demons, or you and I would say, perhaps laden with a million terrible bad habits that have been programmed into the subconscious, and the energy emotionally that the memories of the things they have done bring with them and to their lives. You can work around those type of people, and you can help them, and you can help to heal them, and you can help them to process and to take these things out. And I wish sometimes I could show you more of the children and their progress, but I want to respect their privacy and their journeys. But I've got boys who just wanted to fight and hurt everybody in our care. Everyone. They just used to grab weapons all the time and want to kill everyone in sight. And they were hard work. It used to be painful to go and visit them. I used to not want to go. And those boys now are dancing and singing and filled with joy. And they're singing songs that they're walking in the love of God and they're walking in the light of God. And I see that they've been wrestling with their lion too. But we've been there as well to lend a helping hand and to throw the odd punch in, if you like, to literalize it. And they're healing. And we don't tell the boys to fast, but those around them, fasting is a big part of the culture here, and those around them who are working, doing what we do, many are fasting around them. And when you do that, healing springs forth. So fasting, very powerful thing. But if you want to read something interesting, read the Essene Gospel about fasting. Then read Fasting Works about healing crisis. And you'll see that the two are exactly the same. It's always been around, this message from God, that there's a way to loosen the work of Satan. There's a way to loosen the grip of gluttony. There's a way to loosen the grip of addiction. There's a way to loosen the bad habits that we form, be they monetarily, sexually, or whatever, in our speech, telling lies, whatever it might be. There's a way to loosen those grips. And it's completely free. All you've got to do is either reduce the amount of food you take in and increase the prayers, or stop the food intake for a while and pray. And all people, without fail, will be liberated from those energies that dwell within them. That's my promise. Might take one person a week, might take another person 30 days, might take another person four stages of 30 days with the correct scientific protocol and gaps in between them so as you don't injure your body or harm yourself. But you will go free of them, and you will form better mental habits, emotional habits, and spiritual habits. You will clear your temple and make way for the Lord. God bless.